more and more annoying. As we grow older and our plate becomes fuller with responsibility and things that we have to do, and we have less and less time to do it and less energy to do it, time really does a number on us. But this is true of our spiritual lives as well. When our Bibles become that cobweb-covered treadmill in the basement or the garage, and our prayer life becomes that diet that we stopped so long ago, and our church membership becomes that gym membership that we still pay for but don't really use.
Amen.
Time really does a number on us. People that we love die. Children get sick. Family members go through hardships. And problems come. Life shows up. But God calls us to be fit not only in mind, body, but also in soul. He calls us to stand firm. He calls us to live a life of spiritual discipline. And as we get ready to go into this Lenten season, which many people view as just a time, a 40-day period where I'm going to give up something. But what if we looked at it as a time to go into some intense spiritual training? Our general, one of our battlefield general, Paul the Apostle, from his chains, from a jail cell, gave us the letter that we're going to look at this morning. But he would give us these get fit slogans, right? He would say, run the race. He would say, fight the good fight. Don't train like a boxer that's fighting, beating his fist against the air, but beat down your body so your spirit can reign. Don't run the race in vain, but run to get the crown. Press on towards the goal to what Christ has called us heavenward. Suit up and show up. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that your spirit would have your way with us this morning. That you would open our hearts and our minds to your word. I pray that the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. Lord, open your scriptures to us. Astonish us anew. Call us through your word back to yourself again. And it's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We've spent the last couple weeks following Jesus through the Gospel of Mark, the first chapter. And we began with Jesus coming along the seashore of people's lives down at the local fish camp and saying, hey, follow me and I'll show you how to fish for people. Then Jesus went down to the synagogue and taught with authority, spoke with authority, and opened the scriptures to people and astonished them in the way he taught because they had never heard anything like it. In that same scenario, an evil spirit presented itself, and we saw the authority of Jesus to cast out that evil spirit. We saw the authority of Jesus to speak the words of life into people's lives in a new and powerful way. Then we saw a little revival break out, not at the church or the synagogue, but down at the doorstep of some fishermen. In the most unexpected place, Jesus exerted his authority over sickness and disease and to interpret the word. And we see in Christ, we talked about how in Christ the kingdom had come. That the kingdom and Christ were inextricably linked together. That when Messiah had come, then kingdom had come. And we talked about our belief in the United Methodist Church that the kingdom of God is both a present and a future reality. That the kingdom of God is right here among men and women right now. And we looked at some staggering statistics about death and suicide and drug addiction and poverty and children dying every second from malnutrition and from lack of food. We looked at those staggering statistics, and one thing that we could come up with, one conclusion we could draw immediately, was that the kingdom of darkness is very much alive and well.
Amen. Amen.
The kingdom of darkness is having their heyday today. But we also looked at the fact that the kingdom of God is almost also alive and well. That right now, all over the world, people are in prayer. People are in meditation. People are in worship. And that where people are doing what Christ did, there is the kingdom.
Amen.
Where sickness is being cast out, where demonic spirits are being thrown to the side, where people are finding wholeness, and where people are being fed that are hungry, where people that are thirsty are being provided drink, where people that are naked are being clothed. That is where the kingdom of Christ is. And so the kingdom of Christ is right here in our midst. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Dr. Brian Russell at Asbury Theological Seminary, one of my professors, says that in the Holy Bible, from cover to cover, we can see three strands of reality. In any segment of text that you take apart and look at this, you'll see three major themes from cover to cover. And that's mission, holiness, and community. From the very beginning, we see mission. We see God on a mission of creation, a mission to dwell with his people. We see the mission of Israel to the world. We see the mission of Jesus Christ of redemption and the cross. We see the mission of the Holy Spirit to sanctify people's lives. We see the mission of the church, the ecclesia, the called out ones, and what we're supposed to be doing in the world. We see mission from cover to cover, amen?
Amen.
And we see holiness. We see from the very beginning when God called out Abraham and said, I'm going to make you into a great nation, as vast as the stars of the sky. He said, but walk blamelessly before me. Don't stray to the right or to the left, but walk blamelessly before me. We see in Moses, a covenant is made, a covenant, a behavioral covenant. These are the things that we should do as the called out people of God, and these are the things that we should not do. We see in Joshua, as he prepares to go over to the promised land, that God, he's standing at the promised land, and the promised land is full of these armies that he's going to have to go in and fight against to possess this promised land. But God doesn't send him down to Planet Fitness, or he doesn't send him down to the soldier school or the swordsman school. What he says is, Joshua, be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous to walk in the ways of Moses. Be strong and courageous. Do not let my words depart from your mouth or your mind, but guard them in your heart. Do not stray to the left or to the right, but be holy, be righteous. It didn't matter how Joshua knew how to fight. It didn't matter how good of a battlefield commander he was. God told him to do crazy things, like go down to the wall of Jericho and march around it a couple times and blow some trumpets. It was never a question of his physical ability. It was a question of his integrity, his character. And so we see holiness from beginning to end, and we see real, true holiness revealed in Jesus Christ in the clearest way that we ever could, to love God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and to love neighbor as yourself. And we see all this takes place in community. From that first community that God called to be in community with Adam and Eve, to the community of Israel, to the community that we are now in the church. And the text that we're going to look at this morning has all three of those elements. Mission, community, and holiness. Paul the Apostle is in chains as he writes this letter. Now, some scholars say that Paul didn't really like writing this letter, but being that the Bible says in the first chapter, it says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, I'm going to go ahead and go with what the Bible says. Mm-hmm. And it says that Paul read it, so that's what I'm going to believe. And it's written to a community that's obviously struggling. It's written to a community that's entrenched in this battle. What we saw in Jesus over the past couple weeks in the Gospel of Mark is this collision with the kingdom of Christ that had come and his authority over evil, demonic spirits, and sickness, with the kingdom of darkness. So Paul is writing a letter to say, how do we live in this collision? How do we live in this kingdom of God in, with darkness all around us? And in the 10th verse, it begins with, finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. And we can't really just jump into a passage when it starts with finally, because that means there's been something said previous, right? So this really is the summarization of the whole letter that we find here in the 10th through the 20th verse. But Paul basically lays out how to be a missional community, holy in action. And if you look back over the Gospel of Ephesians, you're going to see he covers salvation, that we're made alive in Christ, that we're one in Christ. He talks about his mission to the Gentiles. He talks about living as children of light in a dark world. He gives very specific instructions. He says, be imitators of God, therefore. He gives instructions of how we should be as wives and husbands. He gives instructions of how we should be as children and parents. And then finally, in the 10th verse, we get this call to arms, this kind of get-fit spiritual slogan that Paul's going to give us in these couple verses. He says, finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. So the first thing that we need to understand about this text is that we are called to live in God's mighty power, not our own power, not our own ability or our own skills, because we can't stand against the kingdom of darkness by our own power. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
We can't be holy as God has called us to be holy as our, by our own power. He says, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. He says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Paul is letting us know right off the bat that there's a very real enemy out there. There's an enemy that he's identifying as the devil. I don't really have time to get into that today, but some people believe that the devil is a being that's out there that's going about like a roaring lion seeking who he will devour, and the scripture really backs that up. Some people believe that the devil is inside us in our own human hearts, and scripture kind of backs that up too. Jesus himself said, from the hearts of men come all forms of evil and idolatry and wickedness.
Mm-hmm.
So there's kind of a darkness out there, there's an enemy out there, and there's kind of a darkness and enemy inside as well. And Paul says, take your stand against that. You're going to see that word stand over and over again in this brief little text that we're looking at. He called us to stand against darkness, against the kingdom of darkness, and to live as children of light. And then he gives us instructions about how we're going to do that. He says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Our struggle is not against each other, folks. It's not against people or a particular political group or a particular race or denomination. Our struggle is not against each other. There's been a lot of changes at Lockwoodsville lately. Amen?
Amen.
There's been changes in attendance. From when we showed up our first Sunday, there's about 12 or so many people here, and now we're averaging close to 60.
Amen.
There's been changes in the presence of children that are just coming out of the woodwork. There's been changes in the way we do worship. There's been changes in the way the bulletin, and some of you have been very clear with me about some of those changes we're not totally happy with or comfortable with, right? Change sometimes causes resistance, and sometimes we want to quarrel with each other and make our enemies into each other. But Paul is clearly telling us that we are not supposed to be in conflict with each other, but against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly realms. He says, therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything to stand. Put on the full armor of God. So God equips us. He gives us the very tools, the very equipment that we need to live in this kingdom of light, as children of light in the dark world, in this present reality of the kingdom. He provides everything that we need. And I'll let you know right off the bat, the enemy has no power over us. The enemy can't really hurt us at all. He can threaten us and he can attack us. But if we put on the full armor of God, then we're invincible.
Amen. Amen.
That's the good news of this text. Now, we have a part to play. We have to put the armor on. And prayer is kind of the undergirding element of this whole thing. We pray on the armor. You can't go buy this armor from the sporting goods store or the Walmart. Or this is not a typical standard military issue armor, right? This is armor that's provided by God that we are placed is placed onto us through prayer. He says, stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. Those of you who are soldiers here this morning know how important a belt is in the battlefield, right? The belt is where you hang off your weapons. It kind of brings everything together. The belt is an important thing for a good soldier to have. And the belt of truth. Now, what you'll see right off the bat is the equipment that he gives us is not real weapons. It's not bulletproof vests. He's not telling you to go get your shotgun or your bow and arrow, Stephen. But he's saying, put on armor of integrity. Put on armor of character. That there's pieces of this armor are not like the armor of the world, but they are a way that we live in righteousness. He says, strap the belt of truth around your waist, the truth of who you are in Jesus Christ, the truth of who you are as a human being, The truth of owning your brokenness, owning your struggles, owning who you are, bringing that brokenness to God and letting it become a tool in His hands. The belt of truth strapped around your waist to be honest in all your dealings and all your affairs.
Mm-hmm.
With the breastplate of righteousness in place. I got to hear Reverend Harold Lewis. January, we had a little district training event, and Harold Lewis spoke on praying on the full armor of God. And he talked about how vital the breastplate of righteousness was, that it protects the internal organs from attack, that it protects our heart. Mm-hmm. And we need to be careful what we let into our heart. We need to be careful what we let into our emotional life. And the way we do that is we walk in integrity and righteousness.
Amen.
We put on God's righteousness. This armor is the very armor that in the book of Isaiah is described as God putting on this armor. Righteousness, walking in righteousness. That's how we guard our hearts. That's how we protect our internal organs. He says, and with your feet, fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. God is calling for some soldiers that will sleep with their boots on. Amen?
Amen.
He's calling for some soldiers that are always ready. Fred could probably give us a lesson on this. A soldier has to have good footwear on, right? A soldier has to be dexterous on the battlefield. Any kind of terrain that they fight on, they have to have their feet properly prepared. Readiness is what this is trying to invoke, a readiness to bring the gospel of peace. And the gospel of peace brings balance and harmony into the lives of believers, children of light. He says, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. What a vital piece of armor the shield of faith is. In the ancient world, a shield was an important thing because there was going to be a volley of archers back and forth before they ever got down to the hand-to-hand combat. And what I want to tell you this morning is remember the Spartans.
Mm-hmm.
The Spartan women, Reverend Lewis said this in his sermon, he said the Spartan women used to send out their husbands and their sons and their fathers, and they would say, come back with your shield or on it. Come back with your shield or on it. Don't leave your faith on the battlefield. The shield of faith is such an important, crucial part because the enemy will attack. The enemy will fire out arrows at you. The enemy will attack your personal life. He will attack your financial life. He will attack your emotional life. The attacks will come. But if we can stand up like the Spartans when they were under attack, this little bold 300 men standing against this vast Persian army, that the Persians told them, we will fire arrows that will blot out the sun. And the Spartans said, well, we will have our battle in the shade then. We need to be prepared for attack. Amen. We need to be prepared and be suited up that when the enemy does attack, that we can stand firm with the shield of faith. The shields in the ancient world were leather and metal, and they were kind of soaked in water, so that when people would fire those arrows that would be on fire, literally, the shield would douse those arrows out. It would put the flames out. And it was a very crucial part of the armor. Hold up that shield of faith to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one and take the helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation is one of the most key elements of this armor. That knowing what Christ did, knowing that we are saved, knowing the price that he paid, his own broken body, his own blood, the price was high. Amen?
Amen.
We need to keep that always at the forefront of our mind. We need to protect what we let into our mind. Protect what we read, protect what we watch, protect what we listen to, the music that we listen to. We need to protect and put salvation over our mind all the time, the helmet of salvation. And he says, and finally, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now notice that the only offensive weapon that he gives is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Up until this point, it's been a defensive stand, right? It's been Christ has already won the territory. He's already won the battle. The cross conquered sin. It conquered death. It conquered the plots of the enemy. All we have to do is stand in the territory that Christ has already conquered, to stand firm. The battle's already been won. Amen? Christ won that battle.
Mm-hmm.
We stand firm and with the belt of truth, with the breastplate of righteousness, with the shield of faith, with the helmet of salvation. And the only offensive weapon that we are given is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. A good soldier needs to know his weapon, amen?
Amen.
Fred sent me the Marine Rifleman's Creed. Mm-hmm. He says, this is my gun, there are many like it. Well, this is my Bible. There are many like it, but this one is mine. My Bible is my best friend. It's my life. I must master it as I master my life. My aim with my Bible must be true. How can we be on the battlefield when we don't know how to use our weapon? How can we call ourselves Christians when we don't read the Bible?
Right.
So when the enemy comes against you with some kind of attack to attack your security or your personhood, you can fire back the 91st Psalm at him and say, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, he's my strength and my refuge, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you'll find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the noisome pestilence that stalks in the darkness. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right, but it will only come nigh you. You will only observe with your eyes and behold the punishment of the wicked if you make the Most High your dwelling, even my God, then no harm will befall you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will give his angels charge concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you'll not strike your foot against the stone. You will not fear the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will be with him in trouble. He will call upon me, and I will answer him. With long life will I deliver him and show him my salvation. When the enemy attacks us, we need to be able to take the sword back to him. Amen?
Amen.
We need to know the Scripture. We need to know the Word of God. And like John Wesley says, we need to be in a disciplined spiritual life. God calls us to be whole spiritually, physically, mentally, in every way. He calls us to be disciplined in our prayer life, disciplined in our spiritual activity through prayer and meditation and the reading of God's Word. He calls us to be good soldiers for Christ. He calls us to stand on the battlefield.
Amen.
He calls us to stand against darkness and tyranny.
Yes, yes.
And you know what? We've been doing a pretty good job of that here at La Clusa lately. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
We had an amazing yard sale yesterday. We got to be in contact with people in the community and tell them, hey, you're welcome to come to this church. We need to be doing those things that Christ did. Are we giving drink to the thirsty? Are we feeding the hungry? Are we clothing the naked? Are we visiting those in prison? Are we welcoming in the strangers? Are people in our community saying, anybody can go there, broken folks are welcome there. Look who their pastor is. Don't let anybody in that church, amen?
Amen.
Are we reaching out to those folks? Are we inviting them into relationship with Christ and relationship with us? Are we taking our stand against the devil's schemes? As we go into this Lenten season, many people look at it as, oh man, I got to give up my TV show for 40 days, or I got to fast on Friday, or whatever that may be. What if we looked at it as a time of training? What if we looked at it as a time to get back to the basics of what the Bible calls us to do? To pray. To read the Bible. To know what our Bible says. To learn how to use our sword. To have faith. To walk in righteousness and integrity. To put on this armor of virtue that God has given us. As we go into the Lenten journey together, I pray that it could be a training camp for us as followers of Christ, that we would be equipped to stand against the darkness of this world, that we would suit up and show up.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, this time to gather together in fellowship, and for your word, which is a light unto our path. And God, we just pray that your Holy Spirit would move in our hearts, that we would hear this call to action, this call to stand, that we would hear the voices of those broken, downtrodden people in our community that need your love. We pray that you would equip us and give us the strength to go out win souls for your kingdom, to bring in the broken. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Wow.